Can I welcome everyone to this, the third meeting of a Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2022. I have apologies today from our convener, Jackson Carlow. Therefore, I will convene today's meeting in his place. The first item on our agenda today is a consideration of the continued petitions. Petition 1855, pardon and memorialise of those convicted under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. The first continued petition for consideration is PE 1855, pardon and memorialise these convicted under Witchcraft Act 1563, which has been lodged by Claire Mitchell QC. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to pardon, apologise and create a national monument to memorialise these people in Scotland accused and convicted as witches under the Witchcraft Act of 1563. At our last consideration of a petition in January, we decided we would invite our petitioners in to hear from them directly. I am therefore pleased to welcome Claire Mitchell QC and Zoe Venditozzi to the committee this morning. Claire is joining us in the Scottish Parliament and Zoe is joining us remotely. Claire, do you have any comments to start with?
Good morning. Well, first of all, just want to thank you very much for the opportunity today to come and speak and answer any questions that you have for us. We're delighted to see that the progress that has already been made with this bill, and we watched with careful interest the first time it called, and we were delighted to note the positive response that it got. So we're just very happy to come here today and answer any questions that you would like us to.
So do you have any initial comments?
Thanks for having us.
Okay. I will start the questions then. What first led you to explore the experience of witches convicted in Scotland, and why did you feel it was important to bring forward this petition to us now?
I work as a lawyer and I've specialised over the past years in cases involving miscarriages of justice. So I suppose I look at the lens of history through things that happen, whether or not they're just or not, whether or not things have been done correctly. And I've always known the story of Scottish witches, but I didn't know them. I wasn't like taught them in school. So it's only later in life that I come to really look at them from an academic perspective and look at what happened. Around about the same time as I was looking at them from an academic perspective, I was also reading quite a lot of things about the lack of representation of women in history, and in particular a book by a woman, Sarah Sheridan, who wrote the book Where Are the Women. She reimagined Scotland as a place where all the statues are to women, all the street names are to women, and it's like a guidebook where you can read all the stories of women that these streets have been named after. So a combination of learning more about my own history and the history of women in Scotland and looking at these witchcraft trials led me one day to be standing in Prince's Street Gardens looking around, and I thought, there are no named statues to women. There are named statues to men. There are memorials to men. And of course, I think it's very important that we memorialise things such as people who have died in war. Memorialisation is very important. But I thought, we're not memorialising Scottish women's history properly. We're not properly recording the history of things that aren't wars or battles. And I thought, I looked over where I was standing. I went round the Prince's Street Gardens, and I stood up beside Wojciech the bear, and I was like, we've got a bear, we've got a full-size statue of a named bear, but we don't have any woman. And I looked at that point up to the castle esplanade, where I know that 300 women at least were killed as witches, and I thought, not only aren't we recording the great things that women have done and celebrating them in statue forms and names of streets, but we're also not recording really a terrible history of things that happened to women in the past. And I say women because under the Witchcraft Act, where 4,000 people were accused, 85% of them were women. So I immediately acknowledge that there were men as well, but the vast majority of them were women. So at that point, I thought, there's a real issue here with what happened with these women. I know these women were wrongly convicted. We all know these people were wrongly convicted. That's where the word witch hunt comes from. This is a witch hunt, means I'm being pursued for something that I didn't do. So I looked around at other countries and see that other countries have addressed their history. The Salem witch trials have been addressed, Norway witch trials have been addressed, German witch trials have been addressed. And I thought, why hasn't Scotland? So at that point, I went back and I wrote the three things that I thought were important to get. A pardon for those who have been convicted of witchcraft. The effect of that would be to restore them to people and to make it clear that what happened to them ought never to have happened. You can't pardon those who haven't been convicted, but in fact, although 2,500 people were executed, those convicted, 4,000 people were accused. So those additional people also went through, they would have gone through a great deal of trauma and being accused. They might have suffered torture, likely to have suffered torture. And we know, for example, that people died when they were remanded in custody accused of witchcraft. So I would like an apology for all those people. And finally, I thought what Scotland should have is some kind of national memorial, something that not only allows us a talking point about our own history, but also lets people who visit our country know our history and know that we have acknowledged our history and have vowed to do better. So it was at that point the Witches of Scotland campaign was born. And very shortly after, I got in contact with my co-campaigner, Zoe Venditozzi. And from there, that's when the campaign started on International Women's Day 2020.
Claire, can I say thank you for that very comprehensive answer, because my next bit was on pardons, apology and the national monument, so I think you've covered them all. Zoe, do you have anything to say on that?
I think just that we think it's very important. It's become increasingly obvious to us during the campaign that this isn't an issue that is relegated to the past, sadly. There are countries around the world where this is a relevant issue now, where the vulnerable are accused of witchcraft and often isolated and sometimes actually killed by mob justice. And we know from campaigners that we've worked with abroad that they would value so greatly Scotland's support of this by saying that we know that it was something wrong in our past and signalling to other nations that we would support them to eradicate accusations of witchcraft as well.
Thank you for that. My colleagues are now going to ask some questions, and I'm going to go to Ruth Maguire. Ruth?
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Zoe and Claire. Thanks for being with us. I wondered if you could start by letting us know what would lead to a woman being accused of witchcraft. There are some misapprehensions, I guess, about the type of women who were accused of witchcraft. I wonder if you could speak to that a little first.
Zoe, do you want to begin?
Sadly, it could be anything. You know, it could be that you had fallen out with somebody over the price you'd paid for something. It could be that you were a difficult person in the community. It could be that you were what we would now view as being vulnerable, but at those times there would have been people that were seen as being unusual or strange in some way. It could be that somebody wanted your land, that you were practicing as a Catholic secretly. It could be lots and lots of different things. And this is something that we've come back to again and again, is that anybody could have the finger pointed at them to say to them that you are a witch, and it'd be very difficult to get out of that situation again. So it could be anything, literally. It wasn't generally, there's a misapprehension that it was healers and midwives, but that's actually due to some recent research that's been done. We know that that's actually just a small percentage of those that were accused. It could be literally anybody.
Yes, the misconceptions really are that the people who were accused were healers and midwives. That's a commonly, or that they had red hair or there was something that marked them out. And very sadly, as a local memorial in Orkney says, a very beautiful memorial, they were just folk. They were just people going about their everyday lives. The difficulty was at that time that both the state and the church fervently were of the view that the devil was working amongst the community, and the ills that befell the community was the devil working amongst the community by way of witches. So a very easy example, if a woman came to the door asking for alms, help, just any form of help, begging, and she left without any money, perhaps because the person who answered the door didn't have any money to give, but she left without money, then if an illness or something wrong befell that family, there would be a suspicion and an accusation that that woman had used witchcraft to do that because she didn't get alms. That's one of the saddest type of examples where someone so vulnerable with no money asking for help eventually ends up being accused in this way. There were various tests for whether or not you were a witch when it came to trial, and one of them was being what reminds me of a sort of James Cagney movie, the phrase quarrelsome dame. If you were a quarrelsome dame, you might be more likely to be accused, or you're more likely to fall out with your neighbours, and therefore the suspicion be if something happened that the devil was amongst us. But that was very much the belief at time. People believed this, that what was happening. And unfortunately, they were encouraged in that belief very much from all sides. So really, it's unsurprising that people had this view. So sadly, no one was immune from accusations. The majority of people were involved were relatively poor. However, it did cut across social and economic divides as well, and some people were rich, and even earls, for example, were accused of witchcraft.
Ruth, do you have further questions, please?
I do, yeah. Sorry, I'm just I just keep coming back in, convener. You can tend
to keep coming back in, indicate if, when you're finished.
Okay, I'll not wait for an invite. Convener, the other thing I'm interested in is who would normally conduct the trials and what sort of evidence would be used to secure a conviction? Claire, you gave an example there of, you know, if someone fell ill after you know, any sort of negative experience, you know, befell a community. Are there any other specific examples that you can give about the evidence that the state would use and who would conduct the trials, please?
Certainly. The trials, another misconception that these were religious trials, they were conducted by the state, and that's why I think it's appropriate that the state provides an apology. What would happen is that allegations would be made in the local community. Now, all sorts of allegations would be made, but they usually related to an ill befalling someone and in some way a narrative being connected with that person, whether or not they'd quarrelled in the market, whether or not they'd had a fight. But examples could have been sadly as easy as we're seen out late at night, we're seen out dancing beside a fire. Just very ordinary examples of what people may have done, but attributed to being a witch and the work of the devil. So when an accusation was made, what happened usually was that they were taken to the local place to incarcerate people, like the toll booth, and they were kept there for a period of time, remanded until they were questioned. Questioning took the form of keeping people awake, watching and waiting, and asking them questions. Now, Scotland, in a sense, was beyond other countries at the time because it didn't physically torture people as much as other people. There are instances of torture, but what they used to do was keep people awake, not just for hours on end, but for days on end, asking questions. Now, of course, we know in the modern day that that is one of the most insidious forms of torture, because people lose their mind if they're not allowed the opportunity to sleep. So after days on end of not sleeping, we know this, by the way, because we have some people who can trace the records of people taking turns to sit and ask questions. They even have records, for example, of how many candles were used burning through the night, because all these things had to be accounted for to keep people awake and ask these questions. So when a confession was obtained, the confession would be used as the basis of the evidence. But confessing alone to these crimes wasn't enough. witches, as people understood it, worked in coven. So you wouldn't be doing this alone. You'd be asked for further names. And of course, people in delirium would give the names of friends, would give the names of families, and sadly led to those people being brought in and to the same thing happening. And we can see why exponentially the witchcraft accusations would grow in that way. So once a confession was obtained, the state would prosecute the matter, and they would be brought before court. They wouldn't be able to give evidence in their own right because it wasn't competent for evidence to be given in their own right. In particular, it wasn't competent for women to be witnesses in a courtroom. However, at that time, I don't think it was, in fact, competent mostly for most or any accused to give evidence. But even in any event, women weren't competent witnesses. So they would bring witnesses to court as somewhat in the same way as they do now, to see what had happened to them, if they'd had a fight, what had been said, or what they'd seen them do. And then they would lead evidence of the confession. And the confession then, as it was now, is a very powerful statement against self-interest. People do confess in the modern day, even not under torture, to things that they haven't done. And people find it very strange that they do so. But we know psychologically that people confess to things they haven't done, even when they're not being tortured. But in these sorts of cases, of course, we know that's exactly what would happen. So it would be akin to a modern day judge who would then decide whether or not the person was guilty of witchcraft or not. And the sentence imposed on people in those circumstances was execution. We see one or two instances of people being banished as witches, but for if the law was being applied properly, which in most cases we imagine it was, execution was what would happen, and people would be executed by being strangled and then being burnt, their body being burnt, and therefore receiving no form of ability for loved ones to bury them or anything of the likes.
Thank you. You mentioned some figures in your opening statement of 2,500 people executed and 4,000 tortured. The survey figures set out in the Scottish Witchcraft Survey of Scottish Witchcraft. How confident are you that they present an accurate picture of the number of women affected by this during the period?
The experts obviously have done a great deal of research on this, they have gone through, insofar as they can, the records of what has happened. What we're finding out now is some citizen investigators, some people look themselves and go and look at records and find additional names. For example, we know that an academic, Judith Gorman or Langlands in Forfar, has looked and found additional names. So if anything, the number might be slightly underreported. The Survey of Scottish Witchcraft itself says in its introduction the limitations that they had, and as with anything else, limitations are time and money for looking for these things. So the numbers that are there are an approximation, but they are an approximation given to us by academic experts who have researched this matter thoroughly. I should also say that when we're looking at those numbers, the 4,000 approximately accused and the 2,500 approximately executed, this was at a time when Scotland was a number of approximately 900,000 people. So we're not looking at Scotland as is in the modern day. We're looking at a much, much smaller country. And therefore, we can perhaps see that the impact of those numbers are even bigger looked at from that perspective.
Yeah, I think that does say something to the scale of it, doesn't it? Can I ask now about the change in law in 1735 after the so-called Glorious Revolution? Can you talk a bit more about that, about the impact on witchcraft convictions and sentences, and any reflections about why it took over 200 years for the 1735 Act to be repealed?
I'll maybe answer just this legal one again, and no doubt Zoe can take over after. In terms of reflection, the fact was that the state and the church vehemently believed that the devil was amongst us. And it wasn't until societal views started to change that there was a change in the Witchcraft Act. The fact that it took so long was simply because I think the society was steeped in that belief during that period of time. What happened when the Witchcraft Act ended was that the Witchcraft Act ended and the new 1736 Act was brought into force. That 1736 Act changed the crime of witchcraft to pretended witchcraft. So automatically, we were already accepting that the crime of witchcraft didn't exist. We changed from that crime being a crime of witchcraft to pretended witchcraft. So I can't imagine a more striking acceptance of the fact that witchcraft didn't exist even at that time. In relation to the sentence which was imposed, the sentence was imposed was non-custodial. I think it went down to a fine or custody, but you could be convicted of pretended witchcraft and receive a fine. Now, to put that into some form of perspective, the last person executed in Scotland as a witch is believed to be Janet Horn. And that was either 1722 or 1727. There's a stone where people debate what date that was. But just such a very short period of time later, there was public acceptance that the Witchcraft Act wasn't appropriate because the crime didn't exist and had to be changed to pretended witchcraft.
Thank you. I wonder, Zoe, do you have anything to add on any of these questions?
No. Claire definitely has covered everything from sort of the legal perspective. I mean, I'm not a lawyer, so I've come into this like any sort of normal person would that's come in that doesn't know anything about it. And just to say that it's staggering the numbers involved. And as Claire rightly pointed out, in such a small population, there was such a lot of people that were swept up in it.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ruth. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Fascinating. The history you've just given us this morning and the understanding of the culture that we had here in the country at the time and the power of the state and the church in making some of these happen. And you've also given us some experiences of what's happening elsewhere in other parts of the world and how they've managed that. But I think my question would be as to how are you managing to support what you're trying to achieve when it's been such a length of time that has taken place. So ensuring that you're trying to secure these pardons, considering that they happened, you know, centuries ago, is very difficult for us and for you, because it's a different world we live in today in many respects. You've explained that, what the culture, the heritage, the knowledge, the myths, the understandings that Scotland had in those days are not anywhere near what we have today. So how are you managing to square that circle? And what have you considered? And what have you discounted? And why have you discounted some of these in trying to secure these pardons that happened so long ago?
Well, of course, we acknowledge that these happened a very long time ago. And of course, it is a relevant and necessary question for us to be able to answer. The first answer I would have to that is, there is no time limit on justice. This was wrong when it happened. These people were not guilty of these offences, and they paid a terrible price in the most brutal way. So the fact that these people were killed and convicted as witches was wrong then, and it's wrong now. One question we might ask, rather than why now, why would we do this now hundreds of years later, one question we might ask is, why didn't we do this hundreds of years before? Why has it taken till now to address this point in Scottish history? And the answer, very much, I believe, is that history is written by the victors. History wasn't written by the people who then, and over those years, couldn't write, the ordinary people who couldn't record their history in that way. So as such, the history of Scotland witchcraft has sort of fallen, I suppose. It's been an academic exercise, but not one for the general public. And I think, most importantly, in respect of the question that you ask about what about the changing of times? If that happened, then how can you square it with the modern day? One of the things that really encouraged me in bringing forward this was the recent parliamentary decision to pardon those convicted of homosexual offences many years ago. Because what the Parliament said when they granted the pardon to those people convicted of same-sex offences was that these people ought never to have been criminalised. And these people ought never to have been criminalised for something that wasn't a crime. And that is true for those people, and I heartily endorse that. It is also true for the people that were killed as witches. One other thing that I do like to reflect upon as well when we're talking about it being a long time ago, 300 or 400 years ago seems like a long time. In the grand scale of history, it's the blink of an eye. We still talk about things that affected Scotland 300 and 400 years ago. Things are very important to us, and I hesitate to say once again, the history we know better about is, for example, things of battles, which happened a considerably long time, more time ago than that. And we still reflect upon and learn from those things. So that's something that I hope that we could do in the modern day, is reflect upon what happened then and bring that of use to the 21st century. Because people say, what's the point? It was hundreds of years ago. You can't help those people now. Well, I say, well, I can. We can try and restore those people properly to history as people who suffered a miscarriage of justice. That's the first thing. But what we can also do as citizens is we can reflect upon what caused that to happen, why people who were in a vulnerable situation were subject to allegations and were used in a power structure that meant that they paid with their lives. And we can reflect upon that wrong and vow to do better. And also, as Zoe has said, and perhaps me speak about more, more broadly, a symbol for the world. I think, Zoe, no doubt you'll have more answers to that question too.
I would just say that although we've changed a lot in that time, we've grown, we're more civilised, we would view ourselves as being more civilised, there's still an ongoing issue with vulnerable communities. We're not at a stage where people are really wonderful to everybody else. And I think it would give a really important signal that we protect the vulnerable in our society, that everybody's got a fair shake of the legal system, and that we are thinking and thoughtful about who we are as a nation. And if we want to be seen as a beacon of intelligence and sensitivity, this is a really good way of saying that internationally, that we're thoughtful and we're looking at our past and we're mindful of it, in the same way that there are moves that are ongoing to look at our past involvement as a nation with slavery. We need to look at the things that happened in the past that we're not proud of necessarily now, understand it so these things aren't repeated again.
You talk about the miscarriage of justice, and I think that's the core where many people would identify. But also many people would identify in those days gone by, it was very male-dominated, the state and the church, and women were persecuted. There's no question, you've given evidence today that explains about torture and the interrogation that they went through. I mean, whether it was an inquisition, that type of structure happened in those times gone by. But that is the persecution of women, primarily by men in communities, seemed to be the what happened at that time. And I think that's very important that we identify that. Because that seems to be one of the main processes that these women were disadvantaged, they were vulnerable, and the state had a control, but it was a male-dominated state that had a control over their existence, and if they continued to have a life after they were put into the situation.
Absolutely, couldn't agree more. That's exactly as it was. And what we want for Scotland in the 21st century and what we want looking forward is we want a generation that comes after us which is equal. We have made great steps forward in the 19th and 20th century towards equality, but we are not there yet. It's still a vitally important part of our country, that we reflect upon where we've come from in order that we can go forward and achieve that equality. And I think the point you make is very valid, very well made.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Alexander. Ruth, I do believe you have some more questions.
Thank you, Convener. Actually, I think they've been covered. I was wanting to explore a little bit more the discriminated nature of things, but actually in evidence, I think the petitioners have told us that predominantly women and people with other vulnerabilities, I think we've covered that aspect. Are colleagues going to ask about Natalie Dawn's bill? Or
ask Ruth, but if you want to do that, you can, OK? On you go.
I'm kind of flying blind here at home, I'm sorry. my colleague Natalie Dawn is bringing forward a member's bill on this issue. I just wondered if the petitioners were able to give committee an update on their knowledge of it and their views on the scope and whether it addresses what they're looking to do.
Yes, we have. We spoke to Natalie. Natalie Dawn approached us when she found out about the campaign and indicated that she was interested in bringing a private member's bill, which we were absolutely delighted about the prospect of. She, I think, was invited here today, but it coincided with another committee that she'd already said that she would attend, so she couldn't attend. However, she passed on to me today that the situation is currently that the consultation process is ongoing. There is a draft consultation that is ready, I think, for submission, I think, tomorrow, in order that that can presumably go out and the public can have an opportunity to consult on that. I believe that that's the next step forward. So that's where that. She said there had been a bit of to and froing about the draft consultation itself, but things appear to be ready. She said she would hopefully passes over a copy of that so we could have an opportunity to read it before it goes in. But that will either happen later today or tomorrow, I think.
Thank you, Convener.
No, thank you, Ruth. Paul?
Yeah, thanks very much. It's been fascinating to listen to this this testimony because I think, well, certainly it's been educational for me just to recognise that this represents a sort of assertion of the triumph of civilization over barbarism, and that's kind of what we're trying to, I suppose, come to an agreement about how best to express in our community and our society today. So I think I'm increasingly realizing the importance of why this has been advocated for. So it's been really powerful. In terms of the members' bill, just briefly, do you intend to try and encourage the scope of that to meet all three elements of what you're trying to achieve in terms of the bill primarily looking at, as I understand it, legislation to offer a pardon, but also maybe perhaps stipulating about terms for a national memorial? Could that be something that could be incorporated into such a bill?
To be frank, I don't know because I haven't seen the draft. I think the draft is only relating to the legislation alone. That's all that's been discussed, so I don't think that contains anything about a national memorial. In relation to the apology, I should indicate to the committee that Zoe Venditozzi and myself have contacted the Scottish Government via writing directly to the Government and the First Minister, requesting that the First Minister consider the government giving the apology on International Women's Day this year. We haven't heard back yet in that regard, so I don't also know whether that will happen. But as I say, the apology is broader and to encapsulate all the people that were accused, because the only those that were convicted can be pardoned, and we want something for everyone. So what we've asked is for a period of time to be set aside for the government, the state, to reflect on what happened and to publicly state what happened was wrong and to present that apology. And no better a time, given the gendered nature of the way the Act was implemented, than International Women's Day to do so. But we're yet to see whether or not there's any possibility that will happen.
OK, that's very helpful. Do you... What exact effects do you hope the apology would achieve by it being formally given by the government?
I don't know. Zoe, would you like to answer that or will I start?
I think it would signify happen, you know, that it's something that would go out on an important day that would symbolise Scotland's understanding of what happened in the past, and it was a miscarriage of justice. And it would give a very important message that we are trying as a nation to look at what we did and to try and reach parity for women in modern society.
I think the National Council, the First Minister's National Council on Women and Girls, has a quote at the start of it. I don't have it to hand, unfortunately, but it talks about history being only recorded by one side and why it's important that history be properly recorded and the history of women be recorded and making ways to do that in order that we can move forward. The idea that we would present an apology on an important day like International Women's Day, it is symbolic, but no less important for it being so. It is an important thing that we see in the 21st century that we accept what happened was wrong. We spoke earlier when we were talking about things happening only 300 or 400 years ago. We are somebody's history. In 2,000 or 3,000 years' time, hopefully children in Scotland will be reading their history books and they will say blithely, from the 15th to the 21st century, and they will say it like it was a blink of an eye. I want to be able to for children in the future to read in a book somewhere that in the 21st century, the Scottish Parliament reflected upon what happened to women and men during this terrible period of time and took the time to remember what happened, to say to those people publicly that what happened was wrong and to try and make ourselves better in reflection as a result of that.
Okay. Yeah, thanks very much. Do you think there's potentially the effect of having the apology might introduce current themes of victimisation in current society? Do you think it might reflect on how people can be bullied and, you know, ostracised in our current society? I think there might be relevant debates that would actually have a meaningful effect on live debates.
Zoe?
Oh, sir?
She cannot hear. Okay, can you hear?
Sorry. I can hear now. Certainly, it would, you know, there would echo there. I think that there would be, there are lines that can be drawn, parallel lines, and we always come back to this idea that we need to protect the vulnerable in society and that we need to be thoughtful and sensitive. You know what? I'm a teacher. I work in additional support needs. I work in that area. So I'm very passionate about this. And I think that we need to be just being thoughtful and clever about this and saying, right, we need to protect the vulnerable. And an apology, I think, would definitely have that parallel where we could say this terrible thing happened because people were picked on because they didn't have power. And that could be definitely used thoughtfully at this time in Scotland.
And I think, Zoe, we've been asked, haven't we, by a number of teachers for resources to help to encourage teaching in that regard?
Yeah, definitely. It's I think they'll have idea of bullying and how the powerful can use that power, you know, for negative reasons and impact on people's lives. So I think that definitely there's huge modern relevance.
You mentioned about the symbolism of International Women's Day. Is there a specific figure that you would wish to issue the apology in the government, or is it just generally the government is satisfactory?
Well, we've written to the First Minister, and obviously it would be ideal if the First Minister, as a woman, issued the apology on International Women's Day. Again, it's very important for women, particularly young people, to see women in positions of power. And as yet, sadly, we're not generation equal, although many women have positions of power. As a generality, that is not across and over the board. So it would be a great thing for Scotland, I think, if it was our First Minister that did that.
And would you prefer that to be in the form of a verbal apology in the chamber of the Parliament, for example, as opposed to a written thing or perhaps both?
Both, any, all. I mean, speaking as somebody who is involved in oral advocacy, it's, of course, powerful when you see someone speaking about these things. So that would be great. But I any kind of apology would be very welcome.
Right. Thanks for that. I'd also just like to touch on the national monument idea, which is really interesting. What Is there other examples internationally? You mentioned that there was a memorial, maybe a community memorial in the north of Scotland, but is there international examples of where this has been done well in terms of national memorial to those who are victims of this superstitious practice?
We should acknowledge, first of all, that, of course, there are local memorials and they're fantastic. And when people say, well, don't you want local memorials? Yes, I do. I want those in addition to those. But it would be great to have a national memorial. There are other examples of memorials, particularly in Finnmark. Zoe, do you want to... It's Finnmark in Norway. Maybe you could tell us about that.
The memorial in Norway and Finnmark is really striking because it was two internationally recognised artists. And it's something that sort of provokes thought, that people go along and it's a big moving monument. You know, it's not just a kind of a static, you know, here are some names, which would also be wonderful. It'd be great to have any national memorial. But I think we've got an opportunity here where we have such an incredible body of artists that are working in Scotland to make something that's really striking, that again signals to the rest of the world that Scotland is a forward-thinking nation. So I'd like to see something that's really actually quite imaginative and would be very, very striking.
Just what do you hope that the idea of a national memorial will achieve, and also where would you look to have it cited? And have you got an idea perhaps around how that might be commissioned? Is it a kind of a competition or some sort of activity that you're planning to undertake?
I think Zoe and I have got the campaign to this stage. We would like, as it were, as the lawyers say, to have an agreement in principle for a national memorial, but we are not ourselves equipped, I suppose, to carry out the task of identifying the national memorial. What we would like is that agreement in principle, so that others whose job it is to do these sorts of things, memorialise, are invited to bid, or however it is done. We have a lot of people contacting us, suggesting that it should be in their area, or suggesting artists. There's a real keenness and a real buzz around the idea. So I'm sure if ever that was done, there would be a lot of people that would be interested in doing it. But we are just interested in having the idea in principle. I don't know if you want to add anything, Zoe.
No, I just don't want to have to build a monument myself. I think that's the main thing, is that we're very keen for it to happen. And there are people who are absolute professionals at that side of things. So as Claire says, we would just like it to be agreed, and then for somebody that really knows what they're doing to make something wonderful and affecting.
I'd also say that we also tweeted a tweet that's got hundreds, perhaps if not thousands, of responses. We tweeted, would it be good in Scotland to have a museum of witch hunts, to have some place that people could go, rather than the beautiful memorial in Finnmark is incredibly striking memorial. But actually a place where people can go and learn. We have a podcast. Zoe and I start a podcast to get people interested in this, and we've been utterly overwhelmed by the interest in the podcast. I should state very clearly, it's not Zoe and I talking about these things. We don't know about them. It's the experts coming to speak to us. It's experts in their area, be it academics, historians, lawyers, activists, authors. The list goes on, but we speak to all those different people about these things. And what is clear is that there's a huge need for knowledge about this area. I spoke about people getting in contact with us to ask us whether or not we'd consider doing podcasts for that were child friendly, and we've been contacted by someone recently who does comics, who writes comics, who wants to do something about the campaign to tell people about these things. So there have been lots of different ways that people have been trying to interact. But the idea of having a place where people could go, be it a museum or a heritage centre, somewhere where people could find out that history, the true history of the women of Scotland, would be a really amazing thing. So I'm not trying to push and change for a national memorial, but we've got an opportunity to think outside the box. Does a memorial need to be, as Zoe says, a static statue? Could it be something else? Could it be something which assists learning, like a physical place where people can learn about these sorts of things?
Okay. Yeah, well, thanks very much for that. I mean, it was just some thoughts on this. As you mentioned the Esplanade Edinburgh Castle and your reflections on that. Maybe an obvious location, I suppose, but it might be worth considering engaging with Historic Environment Scotland to obviously manage a lot of historic properties across Scotland. Obviously, many of them will have been physically involved in the legacy of this practice, and they might find an appropriate location. It might be worth engaging in that discussion now to sort of develop the idea. And another couple of campaigns in terms of memorials that I've been involved with was the Remember Mary Barber campaign in Glasgow to raise the statue to Mary Barber and the rent strikers in Govan. And that was like a community-led thing. There was a lot of persistent fundraising and sort of commissioning a kind of design competition and so on. But it was very much had to be driven by the campaign. And also similarly, recently, the Ungorton Moor Memorial in the east end of Glasgow to the Irish famine victims. Again, it was a kind of persistent community-led campaign. So often these kind of initiatives can help drive the projects. It might be worth just maybe looking at examples like those, perhaps, that might help drive things forward.
Absolutely, thanks very much. And those two were excellent examples of the way that the community wants to have their history properly reflected. And those are two absolutely inspirational community projects. What I think is important, though, is that we don't have to rely on the funding for individuals for this. I think it's important. The community interest is already there. Let me tell you, if I could just pass on all the Witches of Scotland emails that I have to someone else, the community interest, the community support is there. But I really think it's important that in terms of funding that be done centrally and that be done as Scotland as a whole, giving that forward. But you're absolutely right that the importance of engaging the community in this is great. I should say that the Witch's Well that we have at the top of the Esplanade at the moment still sits there. It's a historical artefact, but it says 300 witches were burned here. That's what it said. Some use their power for good, some use it for evil. And people just walk past all the day. And I'm thinking, just take out the word witches there and put in the word woman. And it just sits there and you know, we don't really reflect on it. And it's because the idea of the word witch has permeated into our society in a way that when people say the word witch, it's just a figure of fun. It's just something that's a cartoon. It's just something that's in a book. But we actually don't reflect properly upon that history. And that's why I think having the campaign with these aims and having all these discussions is a really great opportunity for Scotland to reflect on its history.
Okay, well, thanks very much. Really impressive testimony, so thank you. Cheers.
Thank you, Paul. Can I just update the committee? Natalie Dunn's private member's bill is only about the pardon, not about the National Memorial or the apology. So, Claire, Zoe, do you have anything to add that you've not been asked about or you'd like to give in evidence?
I don't think so. I think the questions have been very thorough. Zoe, can you think of anything else?
No, I can't. I just would just like to say again, I just think this is really important. It's not something that belongs in the past. I think it's something that we just need to address now as well, and it just behooves an intelligent nation such as ours.
Can I say, Claire, Zoe, thank you very much for the comprehensive evidence that you've provided today, and it's good to see people back in Parliament giving the evidence at committee, so thank you very much. Could I recommend to committee members that we take the evidence at a future meeting and any matters arising from it? Is that agreed? Can I say thank you once again? And can I suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow the witnesses to leave? Can I welcome everyone back to Citizens' Participation in Public Petition Committee. Our second continued petition is Petition 1854, Review of Adult Disability Payment Eligible Criteria for People with Mobility Needs, which has been lodged by Keith Park on behalf of the MS Society. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove the 20-metre rule for the purpose proposed adult disability payment eligibility criteria or identify an alternative form of support for people with mobility needs. The committee last considered this petition at its meeting on the 17th of November 2021 and agreed to write to Citizens Advice Scotland, Parkinson's UK Scotland, Neurological Alliance of Scotland and MS Society Scotland. The committee was keen to understand whether stakeholders believed changes in eligible criteria for new disability benefits in Scotland would risk other reserve benefits being withdrawn. Responses to the committee's correspondence largely stated that stakeholders do not believe that changes to the 20-metre rule would impact on past supporting to reserve benefits. Stakeholders also challenged the Scottish Government's concern about creating a two-tier system as a result of different eligibility criteria for PIP and adult disability payments. The Scottish Government has previously stated that there will be an independent review of adult disability payments which will report back in 2023, and I understand that the work on this review will begin later this year. Do any of our colleagues have any suggestions? Paul?
Well, thank you, Convener. I've certainly been very impressed by the body of evidence that the committee has gathered already on this, and it seems like it's a fairly consistent refrain that we have from stakeholders about that this wouldn't necessarily impinge upon reserve benefits, that there is a mechanism here to achieve the reform that has been advocated for by the petitioner. Certainly, I think having spoken or sort of corresponded with some of the stakeholders, the view seems to be that whilst they're welcoming the review taking place, it's going to start. I think there's still concern over the pace of that. And also a view of what role does this committee take in regards to that review, whether this committee continues to seek evidence, whether it collates that evidence, and whether it makes the committee itself makes a submission to the review based on the evidence that the committee has gathered. I suppose the question then is not whether we're in agreement that that this is going to happen, this review is going to take place. I think that's a welcome development. It's a question of whether this committee has a role or a locus in making a submission itself, and whether we are required to keep the petition open in order to do so. So I guess that's maybe what we need to maybe consider.
Alexander?
I would agree. I think that we need to get that clarity, convener, so that we understand the implications. And we already had some of that from the Scottish Government in their in what they are suggesting, but also the petitioner himself and the organisation need to think about the way forward that could be used and might be. So I would be very supportive of trying to see if that could be achieved.
Ruth, do you have any comments?
Sorry, convener, trouble with my microphone there. No, I concur with colleagues there.
Thank you. So, if a committee is agreed, we will encourage or ask the Scottish Government to engage with the stakeholders in the review, and if we could get that commitment from the Scottish Government that they will do it, we will bring a petition back to committee and decide what to do with it then. Is that okay? Agreed by members? Thank you. The next item on agenda is our final continued petition this morning. Is petition 1910, amend the forthcoming legal requirements to have interlinked fire and smoke alarms in small houses, which has been lodged by Ian Nicol. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce an exemption for smaller houses from the requirement to have interlinked smoke and fire alarms fitted. This requirement came into force at the beginning of this month. The committee last considered this petition at its meeting on the 1st of December 2021, where it heard that a fund had been put in place by the Scottish Government to help vulnerable households install new alarms. The committee subsequently wrote to the Scottish Government to query how it planned to review the effectiveness of the financial support offered and to establish what work was being done to protect vulnerable homeowners when arranging the installation of new alarms in their homes. The Scottish Government's response stated that it receives regular returns from Care and Repair Scotland on the use of its fund and the number of homes that have received free subsidised alarms. It is also reviewing those returns and maintaining engagement with Care and Repair to identify any gaps in support and ensure the effective use of its fund. It also highlights recent media awareness campaigns, which includes information on alarms types and the importance of using reputable tradespeople to fit these. Petitioner's recent submission raises concerns about the lack of public awareness about precisely what is required to comply with the new standards, a shortage in appropriate equipment and tradespeople, and a lack of clarity in relation to the penalties for non-compliance. The petitioner exclaims that he brought equipment when he first read it about legislation and subsequently found out that it did not meet the requirements. Do any members have any suggestions? Alexander Stewart?
Thank you, Convener. I mean, you've identified many of the issues. I mean, this has been controversial over the timescale, and there's been a lot of anxiety prior to, and I know there was a delay initially from what the government set with their process. But I think that what we now have here is an understanding of where we are with the process, in that there has been a fund set up, that the communication has improved, and there is now a route for individuals who may be vulnerable in that situation. But with aspect to this actual petition itself, in the indicating that they want there to be an exclusion for small houses, that is not going to happen. The government have made that quite clear, that that is not their intention. And I think because of that, and because of what has now taken place in the timescale and the policies and practices that have been put in place, I'm not clear if we can take this any further. So I would be suggesting that under Rule 15.7 Standing Orders that we close this petition at this stage, because I don't feel that there is anything else that can be achieved in the timescale that's been put forward.
Thank you, Alexander Stewart. Any other opinions from committee members? Do we agree to close the petition under Standing Rules 15.7? Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is a consideration of new petitions. As you will be aware, the committee seeks advance views from the Scottish Government on all new petitions before they are formally considered, and these are shared with the committee as part of the meeting papers. Our first new petition today is Petition 1906, Investigate Options for Removing and Reducing the Impact of Central Glasgow Section of the M8, which has been lodged by Peter Kelly on behalf of At Replace the M8. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independently feasibility study to investigate scenarios for reducing the impact of the M8 between the M74 and Glasgow Cathedral, including specifically complete removal and repurposing of the land. In its submission, the Scottish Government confirms that in February 2021, Transport Scotland published a Glasgow Region initial appraisal case for change report. This was one step in the wider transport appraisal process and helped identify the problems and opportunities related to a transport network in the Glasgow region. The Scottish Government advises that appraisal work on the range of the transport options contained within this report has progressed over the summer, and a final set of draft recommendations will be published later this winter. The Scottish Government also highlights that the review has already considered a large amount of evidence related to a whole transport network across the Glasgow region, including the M8 corridor. This has been supported by a significant engagement exercise, which to date has not identified or proposed any significant change to the M8. The submission also confirms that Transport Scotland are aware of the aspirations of the M8 cap at Charing Cross and have been willing to participate in these discussions and will continue to do so. The Scottish Government states it believes that there are currently no need for a separate piece of work in relation to a section of the M8 throughout the Glasgow city centre. Do any members have any comments? Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. This has certainly been an interesting campaign, which I have some familiarity with because they hosted an exhibition during COP26 in the New Glasgow Society in the city. And it seems to have been motivated by the recent developments with the structural condition of the Woodside Viaducts in the centre of Glasgow, which are potentially going to lead to hundreds of millions of pounds being spent on rebuilding this infrastructure, which was completed in 1971. This led to a discussion during COP26 about other cities worldwide, what they have done, best practice, you know, the big dig in Boston, for example. There's other examples such as in San Francisco, Paris, Seoul, South Korea, etc. And there's also an international campaign, the Campaign for New Urbanism, which advocates for reducing the impact of elevated, segregated motorways at high speed through city centres worldwide. It doesn't seem to have been much of a feature in Transport Scotland's considerations so far. I think that's identified itself in its own activity. It has never once actually fundamentally reappraised the merits of having a major concrete elevated motorway through the centre of the biggest city in Scotland, and whether this is actually a sanity check that is needed. Glasgow itself, large amounts of the population were displaced to construct the road. The communities of Cowcaddens, Townhead, Anderston were cleared. The city, actually, Glasgow actually itself, is the only city in the Western world, apart from Detroit, which had 1 million people in it and has then declined back below. It's lost a third of its population in the space of 30 years from the 1960s to the 1990s. So the urban blight caused by the motorway, along with adjacent redevelopment, continues to have a negative effect on the city's urban environment. There's high correlations with poverty, ill health, and other issues that are associated with the roads. Indeed, recently, there was a study carried out that identified that the noise pollution at Charing Cross in the centre of Glasgow is equivalent to standing on the runway at Glasgow Airport. So you can imagine that has only recently been discovered. These are sort of negative externalities, negative effects environmentally of this road that need thorough investigation. And I think the petitioner has identified a major need in public policy to look at this. And it seems to fall between the cracks a little, because Glasgow City Council is responsible for the general urban condition of Glasgow and the normal road network, whereas Transport Scotland and its contractor, Amy, is responsible for the maintenance of the trunk road network. So there is a bit of a disconnect between national responsibility for trunk roads and local considerations about the urban environment. So I do think there's a need to marry the two together and get a coordinated and clear study undertaken. So I fully support the petition's intent, and I think at this stage it would be worthwhile gathering further submissions from relevant stakeholders and attempting to understand whether there's a scope there to actually do a more thorough investigation of the merits of doing something. I don't think it's necessarily about removing the motorway. It's not hard and fast about that. I think certainly some people might advocate for that. Others might be quite alarmed by the prospect of that, which is quite reasonable given the potential implications. But there are certainly practical measures to reduce the environmental effect of the road, such as the capping project at Charing Cross. So it would be good to investigate a spectrum of options that could be undertaken to try and solve some of these problems identified by the petitioner.
Paul, could I ask what stakeholders, obviously Glasgow City Council and Transport Scotland, but is there any else that you would add to that?
Well, I think there's the New Glasgow Society, which is an amenity body in the city. There's also the Royal Institute of Architects in Scotland, for example. There are potentially civil engineering bodies out there, the Institute of Civil Engineers. There's the Campaign for New Urbanism in the United States. There's the City Urbanist in Glasgow as well. And there are other figures who may well be able to offer expert advice. Brett Todrian, who's the former mayor of Milwaukee, who undertook a project in America similarly. And there might be other projects around the world that we might want to sort of write to the relevant bodies to ask of how they did it. I don't know. There's a number of different ways in which we could proceed. That might require further reflection. Maybe invite the petitioner to suggest potential stakeholders to engage with as well. But there are community councils adjacent to the road that might be worth communicating with. And there's also the Glasgow Institute of Architects. So there's a range of different bodies and interest groups out there that we could we could go to. I haven't compiled an exhaustive list, so I could come up with more probably. But I do think there's definitely merit in thinking about who we speak to. That not necessarily saying all of those people I mentioned are relevant or necessary to contact, but there are a number of groups out there who might be worthwhile sort of engaging with. But they're just some initial ideas.
Paul, thank you very much for that comprehensive list of stakeholders, and I hope the clerks have got it all.
I'm happy to follow up in writing, if I can reflect on maybe some ideas, but also I'm sure the petitioner might have some ideas.
That would be absolutely great. Is everybody aggrieved with that, colleagues? Thank you very much. The next new petition is petition 1915, reinstate Caithness County Council and Caithness NHS Board, which has been lodged by William Sinclair. The petitioner highlights particular concerns about the loss of consultant-led maternity services and the closure of two palliative care hospitals in Caithness. In its submission, the Scottish Government states it is committed to ensuring the decisions are taken at the right level and as close to possible as was most effective. It highlights the joint local government review with COSLA, which it states aims to strengthen local democracy by considering how power could be shared between national and local government and with communities. The submission also highlights ongoing work to create a national care service and recent consultation on this topic, stating that there are currently no plans to bring about any changes to the structure of the NHS boards. The Scottish Government states it also states its intention to introduce a local democracy bill within the lifetime of this Parliament. The Scottish Government submission explains that a decision to change from consultant-led obstetric unit in the Caithness General Hospital to a midwife-led community maternity unit was taken on the grounds of safety. In relation to palliative care, the submission advises that while Caithness does not have specific hospice facilities, the teams locally work very closely with Highland Hospice, located in Inverness. Colleagues, do you have any comments to make? Ruth?
Thank you, Convener. I think that, notwithstanding that the Scottish Government don't have a plan to, there's no intention of restructuring health boards, I think the crux of this matter is healthcare for individuals in Caithness. I wonder if colleagues would agree if we could write to NHS Highland to get an update on the community midwifery unit, including a timescale for its completion. We see from our papers as well that there are another couple of petitions. Agency to advocate for the healthcare needs of rural Scotland and find solutions to recruitment and training challenges for rural healthcare in Scotland. That's PE1845 and PE1890. I wonder if it might be helpful to consider all these petitions together and invite the petitioner to give us evidence.
Thank you for that, Ruth. Colleagues, does anybody else have any comments? Do we agree with Ruth's recommendations? Thank you, committee. Right. The next new petition is petition 1917, provide full legal aid to all parents fighting for access to their children, which has been lodged by Amy Stevenson. The petitioner highlights that when couples separate and are unable to agree a contact arrangement, parents are often faced with high court costs and contact center access fees, which they may struggle to afford. The petitioner states that this often results in many parents experiencing mental health issues. The Scottish Government's submission on this petition highlights a 2019 consultation on legal aid reform, which resulted in 75% of respondents agreeing that those who could afford to contribute towards cost should do so. The Scottish Government's submission also explains that the number of cases relating to child contact and residence means that providing legal aid without a means to test for those seeking those court orders would have a considerable impact on the legal aid budget. The submission advises that the Scottish Government provides financial support to Relationship Scotland for the operation of contact centres. Colleagues, looking for some comments, please.
Convener,
Ruth.
Thank you. I appreciate the response from the Scottish Government there around the details of legal aid and the consultation that's already passed, and I appreciate the point made about means testing and affordability of budgets, etc. But I think this is a really important matter, and certainly one that comes up in constituency casework for myself, and I'm sure other MSPs on the committee. The petitioner talks about, you know, the mental health impact on parents. I think that we also probably need to remember that, you know, it's not just about accessing justice, it's about the well-being of children, and we need to make sure that what we have in place is helpful as possible to families going through breakups and looking after children. I would suggest that we, in the first instance, write to some stakeholders to seek their views on the issues that are raised, perhaps including One Parent Families Scotland, Relationships Scotland, Scottish Civil Justice Council and Scottish Legal Aid Board.
Thank you for that, Ruth. Alexander?
I mean, I concur very much with Ruth Maguire's comments. I mean, you know, there is no doubt that there's an impact on mental health here. And in some of these situations where domestic abuse cases, the follow-on from that is important, that's recognised. And our own Committee on Equality, Human Rights and Civil Justice did a roundtable only yesterday on a very similar topic to this, with access to support for families and for young people. So it would be useful maybe to take some, what came from that evidence session yesterday might be quite useful for us to think about what we're taking from this as well. So I would be very keen to continue to see what we can, more information we can glean from this, and then come back at a further stage and analyse that.
Any other comments from committee members? Paul?
Just to say, I concur about I recognise some of the issues being raised in casework, and I think the petition has identified a valid public need to investigate this further, so I'm content with that.
Yeah. It is agreed. We will keep the petition open and write to all relevant stakeholders. Agreed? Thank you. The next new petition is Petition 1919, Prohibit Advertising and Promotion of High Caffeine Products to Children for Performance Enhanced, which has been lodged by Ted Gourley. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ban the sale of fast-release caffeine gum to under-18s for performance enhancement. The petitioner believes that the continued sale of such products puts children and young people at risk of serious harm. Petitioner cites examples of where such gum has been distributed widely at races, with the caffeine content exceeding the daily recommended dose for a young person. Petitioner points out that both Scottish Athletics and Sports Scotland have previously warned of health risks in consuming high doses of caffeine, particularly for under-18s with undiagnosed medical issues. In its submission, the Scottish Government advises that a consultation was held in December 2018 to February 2019, on ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people. The consultation did provide an opportunity for respondents to raise concerns in relation to other food and drink products, such as caffeine gum, as chewing gum falls under a definition of food in the food law. The Scottish Government is currently considering responses to the consultation and has undertaken to publish a report that will update the committee in due course. In May 2015, the European Food Safety Authority published its scientific opinion on the safety of caffeine. It advised that a single dose of caffeine up to 200 milligrams from all sources do not raise safety concerns for healthy adult population. For children and adolescents, the European Food Safety Authority opinion is that there is insufficient information available to set a safe caffeine intake. However, it considers that due to children and adolescents processing caffeine at least at the same time, at the same rate as adults, a single dose does not concern for adults may also be applied to children as a daily limit. Do members have any comments? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think this petition has some merit. There is no doubt that caffeine has had and continues to have an effect on young people, and the petitioner himself has identified some of the concerns. And I think that it would be useful for us to keep this petition open and to seek some more advice and some more information from stakeholders. They may include the Children and Young Commissioner, the Athletics, Scotland Athletics and Sport Scotland, and the Cardiac Risk for Young and Food Standards in Scotland. I think all of those would be more than willing to support and give us some information on the caffeine intake and the difficulties, and that would give us a much more balanced approach as to where we can take this for the future, convener. So I would like to move that we keep it open and we ask for that information to be submitted, and then we can make a judged response from that.
Thank you, Alexander Stewart. Does any other committee members have any comments? On that, we will keep the petition open and write to relevant stakeholders. Is that agreed? The next new petition is Petition 1920, introduce more through follow-up care for women with diabetes, which has been lodged by Laura Hastings. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide more further follow-up care for women with diabetes. In its submission, the Scottish Government outlines a range of initiatives that are available to educate and support those living with diabetes. This includes its Women's Health Plan, published in August 2021, and its Diabetes Improvement Plan, which was published in February 2021. This has 8 priority areas, including mental health, and a focused set of actions overseen by the Scottish Diabetes Group. Do any members have any comments? Paul?
See, I will note the submission from the petitioner and the personal experience that she's had, and also that she has engaged with ministers and also parliamentarians on this issue. I think if she hasn't been satisfied with that, then there is a valid basis in which to invite further submissions. Perhaps we could write to the relevant charities that deal with this. So there maybe is the Scottish Diabetes Group, who are the National Advisor Group. There maybe is relevant charities that we can reach out to sort of request if they're satisfied with the measures the Scottish Government has taken. And establish whether there's a wider impetus for improvement. Obviously, the Scottish Government have indicated they have a relevant strategy in place, in both in terms of women's health and diabetic health. So whether that has been peer-reviewed, whether there is a further concerns, I think it's worthwhile establishing whether that is the case.
Thank you, Paul. Colleagues, do you have any further comments? With Paul's recommendations, are we happy to keep the petition open and write to relevant stakeholders? Thank you, colleagues. Our final petition this morning is Petition 1921. The Scottish Government must confirm that it will not introduce voter ID in devolved elections, which has been lodged by Maddie Dehesi on behalf of Hands Off Our Vote. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to confirm it will not introduce voter ID in devolved Hollywood or local elections in Scotland. Communicate that to the Scottish voters. In its submission, the Scottish Government confirms that it has no plans to introduce voter ID in devolved elections. It notes that in this contrast, the UK Government's election bill, which is currently at its second reading in the House of Lords. The submission explains that the UK bill will require voters to show an improved form of photographic identification before collecting their ballot paper to vote in the UK Parliament general elections in Great Britain, local elections in England, and Police and Crime Commissioner elections in England and Wales. The Scottish Government is also aware of the concerns regarding confusion in the event of a UK poll occurring on the same day as a Scottish poll, with different identification requirements for each contest. It also notes that additional responsibility this will place on presiding officers in each polling station to police the ID requirement. Do any members have any comments, please? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. We've already had the Parliament make a decision on this. I mean, it wasn't a unanimous decision by the Parliament, but it was a majority decision that indicate that there will be no voter ID. So in doing that, I think that we should be closing this petition at this stage, because the Scottish Government's made it abundantly clear that they will not be. But I do think that in closing the petition under 15.7 standing orders, I think it would be important for us to write in just in case there is the confusion that may occur if elections for the UK and for the Scottish appear on the same day. I know that is potentially unlikely, but in the event that that could happen, I think it would be useful to get a view on that. But I do think that the decision has been made and it will not take place. And I think in doing that, we can close the petition.
Any other members have comments? If the committee has agreed, we will close the petition under Rule 15.7 of standing orders. Agreed. Committee, the petition 1906 on the M8, would the committee agree to delegate responsibility for signing off the stakeholders, number of stakeholders, to the convener? Thank you. That concludes our meeting in public this morning. The committee's next meeting will take place on Wednesday, the 9th of March. The meeting will now move into private session to discuss our final agenda item. Thank you.